Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. Welcome to VizConnect, connecting you with the art of data visualization and storytelling. So if you ever want inspiration from our community, including Zen Masters, Ambassadors, and Community All-Stars, those are a couple of which we have today, feel free to check out our VizConnect sessions library with many webinars and a growing community. So make sure you subscribe, hit the notification bell, so if you can't catch somebody live or want to see old recordings, you can go ahead and check that out immediately. On LinkedIn, we have a 2000 plus member community. We often share great stuff, including recordings, blog posts, and other items that would inspire those that want to be connected with our family on LinkedIn. So just make sure that you join our group there. We're happy to have you, and we're excited that there are so many people coming there and helping our community grow. So if you're starting out with Tableau and haven't really began your journey yet, a good place to start is with our Tableau learning path. There's been over 10,000 views, many favorites, and so forth, and it's a very simple visualization we put together a while back, sharing your journey and helping you get to where you want to go for pretty much free. So pretty much everything here is a link to something that should help you learn and excel in Tableau with many great community free resources. So check that out if you have a chance, and just look that up on Tableau Public. Sagar and I are also working on mentoring meetup. We always need mentors, so we have a lot of people waiting for a mentor, and we would love you to sign up for a mentoring meetup if you want to be a mentor. And we do have it open for those that need mentoring as well. So you jump on mentoringmeetup.com and select on I want to be a mentor, which is on top of the site, or I want to be mentored, and fill out the appropriate forms. And today we have a couple great presenters, 2/3 of the trio challenge, Jody Gautam and Vani Agarwal. Jody will start first, and she's going to be talking about creating data art using parametric equations in Tableau. And our second topic will be from Vani, and she's going to talk about quick tips and tricks on using parameter and set actions in Tableau. So to begin, Jody is currently working as a technology analyst for Infosys Limited in India. She loves experimenting with data to find data stories and visualize them using a balance of analytics and design. She's always in search of different and fun ways to represent data insights. She has a special place for colors, shapes, and designs in her life. So I'm excited to share with you, Jyoti.
Thank you, Adam. Let me share my screen. Is it visible?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So, hey everyone, I am Jyoti Gautam, and today on this VizConnect session, I'm going to present on the topic of creating data art using parametric equations in Tableau. And through this visualization and through this method of representing art, we are going to send the message that mathematics is beautiful. It is not always boring, and when we represent it visually, it is really aesthetically very beautiful. So let's go on. So a little bit about me. So I am working as a technology analyst at Infosys Limited, and there I'm working in the data role. We are working on the back end in the data engineering, building pipelines and working with the back end stuff. And I was recently featured as a W Public featured author. And I love creating visualizations on health, education, and art. Basically, I am always in search of a balance between the art and technology and mathematics. So Tableau is a place where I found that balance, and I love doing different experiments over there. And I was introduced to Tableau Public and DataFame community in October 2020. Okay, and apart from visualizing, my other hobbies include reading books, and I basically read nonfiction books on business, science, self-help, health, and fitness. I also do doodling and writing in my free stop time, and I also do abstract painting. So recently, three people, Vani, I, and Kavya, are working on a trio challenge, which is a way to level up our learnings in data visualization field by putting out a challenge every week. And we are 6 weeks into this challenge, and it is really helping us. And yeah, if you want to discuss anything, you can reach out to me over Twitter or LinkedIn. I will be happy to discuss anything. Okay, so we are today going to work on the parametric equations. So I just wanted to show you some of the parametric equations which are used by me in creating these visualizations. So this is the one representing mathematics and art, and this is the interactive version of the same with some complexity, putting out colors and all things. And this one, I would say, is basically accidental art, because I was experimenting with different equations and I came to this one. And yeah, this one is a butterfly, which is created using the parametric equations in Tableau. And this is the first one which I created. So it is always special. Okay. So today we are going to discuss this visualization, which I created first, and its workbook is available on Tableau Public. You can always download and explore it. And I have also written a blog regarding the step-by-step procedure to in this visualization, and it is available on Wizard Pandey site. I can give you the link after the session, and you can go check there also. Okay, so before starting, I would like to acknowledge few things. This parametric equations are used by many DataFame community members, and I'm not the first one. I have just followed their footsteps, and I have got the inspiration from Ken Flerlich. You might be knowing this name very well. So there was a Beyond Show Me series, and in the part three of that, they described about the parametric equations, and that opened the gates for me about the things which we can do in Tableau. Okay, so, and the second one is Alexander Varlamov, and he had written a blog on creating the human faces in Tableau using the parametric equations, and there is a link provided here. I'll provide you. You can go and check out. That is really amazing. And so these are the two people whose work I have followed, and I was able to create these visualizations. So do check their work on Tableau Public and reverse engineer that. It's really beautiful. Okay, so why I started data art? So there are a few things. First is curiosity. which is always in all humans. So out of curiosity, I wanted to do something beautiful in Tableau, apart from the BI things like analysis and pattern finding and trends, which we do normally. And second thing is that I find the designs really beautiful, which are created maybe through the geometric art or digital art, which are really famous nowadays. We put the algorithms and there are very beautiful designs which come out, and which may not be actually realistic, but they come out. And the third is that I wanted to put out a message that mathematics is not always boring. It is not just numbers. And like Ken says, that it's not always black and white. It can be beautiful, and we can put out the colors into that. And so that's what we do today. Apart from that, Tableau is a place, it's a BI tool, which we normally use for analysis, but Tableau provides a lot more than that. Tableau is a is like a canvas where we can put whatever we want, whatever we imagine in our minds, we can put out there. So it's really interesting, and I wanted to challenge myself regarding these things. I wanted to explore the Tableau's this space. So these were the reasons I took data art. Okay, so let's start with the parametric equations. Parametric equations are actually part of mathematics in the field of trigonometry. And so I'm also not very good at mathematics. I have done the equations and all things in my school time. So I went through a little, some of the blogs before doing this. And from there, if I want to put in simple lines, what is parametric equation? So parametric equations are represented with the help of functions, which we can use to point the XY points on any canvas. And using those points, we can create curves, designs, whatever we want. Parametric equations can be simple, as designing for a simple circle or a line, or it can be very complex, which can lead to very beautiful designs. Here, we use a single parameter. Here, we are calling it t. You can call it anything. And this t value defines the different angles and different things through which the design and curve of the parametric equation changes. And the t value can be negative as well as positive. Here in Tableau, I created a circle with the help of these x and y values of the parametric equation. Here r is the radius, and cos and sine are the normal mathematical functions, and t is our single parameter. And here I have taken the t value as 0 to 1000 because I really wanted to densify the circle, but it can be any value which you are good with, like 0 to 100 or 0 to 200, anything. And today in parametric equations, we are going to use the x and y values which are written out here. I know these look a little bit boring, but yeah, this stuff we need to do if we want those beautiful designs out. So these are the x and y values which we are going to use. I have just written out here. And I got to know about these equations from a blog, Life Through Mathematician's Eyes. And there are other sources as well there. Like Wolfram Alpha is a site where there are a lot of curves and human faces and different cartoons whose curves are given in the form of parametric equations. You can just check the x and y values from there, convert it into the form which is valid for Tableau, and then explore it. And if you want to know the Python code to change the x and y values from normal to how we represent in Tableau, there is a blog by Alexander. and I will give that at the end of the session. You can go through that. Okay, so now we are going to jump into Tableau and create our visualization. Okay. So this is the visualization. We are going to start with the X and Y value. I have taken the same X value which was shown there in the presentation. And similarly, I have taken Y value. It is same, okay? And after that, we are going to have the T value. Okay, just a minute. Let me show you the data source as well. So for the ease, I have taken the things in Excel. Like I have taken the P value, which I'm going to tell you after some time. For now, let's focus on T value. So T value is from 14 to minus 14 to 14 with the difference of 0.01. I have written all the values there here in Excel for the ease purpose, but you can also take values like minus 14 to 14 and then go in the Tableau and create the bins with a size of one bin as 0.01. That will also work. This Excel sheet is available on the blog which I had put out, and you can download from there. And so we have these two sheets. We have created an inner join by putting the one value here and one value here. Let's jump into the sheet now. So these were the X and Y part, and we are just going to put out them here. And we are going to change it to line, and this T value is going to come on the path. So now there is just one point. And what we are going to do here is that we are going to change it to a dimension. So here what we see is that we have got a beautiful thing, a pattern here. It is completely densified. And next we are going to create a parameter T with the help of this T value. And we are putting it as float, and it has some 1 to 14 value with the step size 0.15. And let me show this parameter here. And so now if I change it, nothing is happening over here. So there's a filter created that we want the value of T to be less than or equal to this parameter. You can use the parameter actions as well here. We are going to put it as true. So the T value, if we are decreasing, so our this pattern is getting less densified. If I increase the value, it is getting densified more. And if I put it out as whole, this is the full size. So I wanted it to be somewhere here. So this is the thing. But in our dashboard, we have four instances of the same thing. So to create this thing, what we need is we need to rotate this one pattern at four different angles, right? So here I checked one blog by Ken where he told us that we can actually rotate a single thing on a particular point. Let me show you his workbook. I had just downloaded his workbook here. Okay, let's just play it once. Okay, so what's happening here is that this shape is rotating at different angles, and this is what we want. But here we want to retain the previous place and we want to rotate it as well. So he had given out the formulas which he had used. So what is happening in these formulas is that the X and Y values which we are using for our design, those are going to be the same, but we are going to put an angle at which we want to rotate here. let's jump to our workbook. And yeah, so we have used his formulas here. What we are doing is we are using the x and y values, which we used here. And then with the sine and cos, actually, this is the equation for a single circle. So what we are doing here, okay? And the angle is the angle at which we want to rotate our value. Suppose we want our design to be in four parts at one place, then what we will do? And there is a 360 degree angle, which we will divide by four, okay? So this is the angle value, and we are putting out index because we want to retain the previous value as well. So angle here, we have divided 360 by whatever value we want. So here P comes into the role, which we had earlier saw in this Excel sheet. So at one time, I'm saying that we can create the 24 different instances into a single visualization. You can put the more as well, but then it will look very clumsy. So I have taken just 24 to show here. If you want the picture to be static, you can also put 4 here. 360 divided by 4, there will be only 4 instances at one place. But I'll show you why I have taken this. Okay, so this is the P value. Now we have created a parameter for P as an integer, 1 to 24. Let me show the parameter here. Okay, so nothing is happening here until we put out the filter. In filter, we are saying that the value of P is going to be less than equal to the parameter. Let's put this here. True. And we are going to put P on the detail as well. Now, the X and Y values, which we have taken to rotate, they are going to come here. Instead of X part and Y part, we are going to use X total and Y total. So let's put X total here and Y total here. Let me change it to dimension. So this is the visualization which we wanted. So we have taken the parameter as P and it is coming out like this. If we decrease the value of parameter 3, so we are having 3 instances, 2, we are having 2 instances, 1, we are having 1 instance. And this we can do with any shape we want or any pattern we want. So I loved it at this place, but you can obviously increase it. And if you see, if I increase it to suppose 20, it's really getting clumsy. We can decrease the size. So there are many experiments which we can do with the help of this. I don't like the color here. Anyway, whatever it is. So we can keep 4 here. Yeah, so this was the thing which we wanted, and here we have it. So this we have used here, and in the way, if you want, we have another visualizations as well. Like here, I have created a butterfly. The X and Y values for the parametric equation for this pattern were very complex, but I have all put all those on Tableau Public. You can download the workbook and explore that. And but the base for parametric equations is going to be same, which we have used here, that we want to have a pattern and rotate it. And yeah, this is it for today. And if you have any questions, put them in the chat and we'll answer. And thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Jody. That was a very incredible presentation. I know these aren't best practice principles or anything like that, but for those that want to really be inspired and push Tableau to its limits, you really want to play around with these, and it really helps you develop a different passion for Tableau that goes outside of creating business dashboards, bar charts, and crosstabs. So it's very exciting to see and how you're able to do it and do it so cleanly and beautifully as well. I did share your links in the chat so people can access those, so we don't have to worry about that later. We don't have any questions right now, but my question for you is, how has this inspired you to do more with Tableau at the workplace? Knowing that this isn't really related to what you do at work, but has this increased your passion for doing other stuff work-related? And has it at all helped you create visualizations or think about design at the workplace, even though this isn't directly related?
Yeah, we can say that this is not directly related to what we do in the business world, like business dashboards we create. We cannot put this into that space, but like we say, that it is always helpful to have all these things in our armor so that we can use when we get a chance to do that. And it really has helped me in increasing my creativity around my work, and it's really fun. And we through this these visualizations, I have came to know that Tableau is not just a BI tool. There is a whole lot of space to explore, and this is just the starting point. Like I have used the parametric equation. Similarly, people use a lot of things to create different visualizations which have some visual impact, which creates an instant connection with human mind, because we always look for things which are beautiful, and those always impress our minds. So it is always helpful to have that. And in business area, it depends upon the need and the problem which we are trying to solve. If it is like we want to show the numbers like 89% and 93%, then obviously the line chart is the best thing which we can do. But anyway, in 100 times, we can get one time where we can use these type of things as well. And they really help to brush up your Tableau skills, and they actually keep you connected to the data viz field, because then you are always curious to know different things.
A great response. And the one thing I have noticed recently, at least with employers and businesses, is that they're starting to realize there's more to data visualization than dashboards. And sometimes they want something splashy and infographic or something to show to clients or whatnot. And it's great that you have a tool in Tableau and have the capabilities of doing that if it's needed.
Yeah.
So thank you so much, Jody. Now we're going to pivot to Vonnie. Vonnie is a 2020 graduate in the field of accounting and finance. Prior work was graphics, web design, as well as a developer at Enhanced Consumer Connect. She works as a data visualization and business analyst intern at BlueThinQ, prior to her current role as a Tableau developer trainee at Neen Opal Inc. With that, please share your screen and your presentation, Vonnie. We're excited to see that.
Thank you so much, Adam, for having me. So like Adam said, I'm Vonnie. I'm from Kolkata, India. I have recently done my graduation. I actually came across learning Tableau in this lockdown itself, when I shifted my career from web designing and development to data science. And Tableau was really amazing. And so I just started gradually using it with the help of taking part in various community projects like Make a Woman Day, Real World Fake Data, and so on. And also, like Jyoti said, I'm a two-third part of the Trio Challenge, right? And unlike Jyoti, today we are going to learn a lot of boring stuff which does not look good, and it's mostly used in the business world, which is parameters and sets. So these are the things, you know, which I came across while working at my internships and jobs, which regularly come in handy while working on client projects. And I have to say that a lot of these has been inspired by various blog posts by Playfair Data Enterworks and obviously the Flutter twins. I mean, I have not come across a topic which they do not have on their blog. So do check these out if you want to understand what I'm talking about in detail, right? So the first thing that we're going to talk about is the drill down. So drill down, basically what I mean with the help of this is like whenever we have a lot of subcategories, right, putting them out in a chart sometimes can look like a clutter, right, because there can be a lot. Right now we only have a few, but if we have like hundreds of subcategories or something, it can look very confusing. So that's where we can have a drill down, where we just click on the category we want to see, and we can see all the subcategories beneath it with the help of drill down. So coming to this, making this is fairly very simple. What we have to do is get our subcategories in our rows, and what do you want to map out? Like if you want to map out our sales or profit, we can just have them. And also we want to see it as per our category, right? So this is what we have. Now if I map it into a bar chart, so right now there are a lot of subcategories on the screen at the same time, which can be very confusing for people. So the first thing we'll do is to create a parameter which basically says that, you know, it is a string, because subcategory and category are strings. And it just allowable values is all, because I want all my values to come, and that's it. The second step, very important step in creating a parameter, is to make a calculated field to actually make those parameters work. So the field is basically saying that, you know, whenever I have selected a subcategory, whenever I selected a category, then I should be able to see all my subcategories. Otherwise, it's category, just let it be. Right. And now I'll just quickly show my parameters. Now, whenever I click, nothing is happening, right? Because we have not put these calculated fields anywhere in our view. So instead of having subcategories, we'll replace the subcategories by our calculated field now, right? Now, even now, when I click on this, nothing happens. So this is where parameter actions come into the picture. I'll have to add an action which says that, you know, whenever I'm clicking on something, it should, you know, result in a parameter action, where clicking on it will go to my parameter category or subcategory. And the field which is changing is my calculated field, which is this one. And whenever I clear the selection, just keep the current value, right? Now when I click on a category, because it's a category, it will go into my subcategories. Otherwise, it will stay as a category. Now, coming to the second thing is measure swap, which I mostly use a lot. What measure swap means is basically, like right now, we are showing quantity of all our subcategories through a bar chart. I might want to see sales, or I might want to see profits. So instead of having multiple charts in the same view, we can just have a measure swap drop down, which allows the user to select what measure they want to see on the y-axis. Now, to take it a step further, what I have done is I have added a header where you can select whatever measure you want to see, and you will be able to see that. It's a bit visually more appealing if you want to go for it. So the first step to do this is to actually make this bar chart. So I'll quickly go and again put my subcategory, and I'll just choose one measure right now. Right, that's it. Now, the second thing I'll do is create a parameter which basically includes all the measures I want to show. Right now, I only want to show three measures. The important thing to note here is the value whatever value we write, it should exactly be the same. The spelling, the case, all should be the same as mentioned in our data set, right? And that's it. Now, the other step would be to create a calculated field, which tells that, you know, whenever the selected measure is sales, then I want to see my sales. If it's selected profit, then I want to see profit. Otherwise, the third one, which is the quantity. Now, again, putting sales here will not give me the desired result. So I have to choose this measure instead of sales. And then I'll show my parameter. Now, when I change it, my graphs are also changing. Correct? The thing which I don't like is whenever I select a measure, I have no clue what I'm selecting because there is no indication on the axis. So what I like to do is bring my parameter before my measure in my rows. So now I have what I'm selecting and I'll just hide this. Now when I select, I also get the name, what I selected on my y-axis. To get the headers, what I've done is made a very small Excel file, which only says whatever measures I've selected, and I gave the name measures. I went to my workbook and I added that sheet in my data source. And what you have to do is simply bring in your measure names. Your measures in your columns and your measures in the text value. And I'll hide my headers because I only want to see the values. And now I'll go to my dashboard where I'll put my measure swap sheet and I'll put my headers above this. I'll just do entire view and I'll decrease the height of this and hide my header. Now, when I click on this, nothing will happen because this is not mapped to the chart. So I'll go to my dashboard actions and now I'll choose again, change parameter, where I want to say that, you know, whenever I choose anything on my headers sheet, the parameter which should run is the measures and the field on which it should run is the measures. And that's it. Now, whenever I select anything, I am able to see that particular measure, that particular chart. That was it for the sheet swap. Now we have our show and hide layers with the help of parameters. Map layers are fairly something new which Tableau has introduced. So what we'll do, what we want over here is, you know, whenever I say that show state, it should be showing all the states which I have in my data set. Whenever I say hide state, it should only show me the regions, right? So we'll quickly make our map, which will say for all the regions, let's just see our sales. And I'll convert into a filled map. That's it. Now I also want one more layer of my city. So I'll bring it and I'll drop it on the marks layer. And I'll convert it into a map. And I'll also again bring my sales amount. Put my city colors. All right. Now, what I want is I'll create again a parameter. Now, this is going to be a Boolean, which will say that, you know, let's just select the type Boolean. And I'm saying that whenever the value is true, that means it should show my states. Otherwise, it should hide my states. That's it. And I'll do show parameter, the side part. Yeah. So right now, nothing is happening because we have not created a calculated field for it. So our calculated field is fairly simple. It just says that, you know, if the show and hide value by default is true, So whenever it's true, I want to see my states. I just quickly edit it to settings. I want to see my settings. And again, I'll instead of putting cities here, I'll change it to my calculated field. Now, whenever I do show state, I can see my states. Otherwise, I do not see my states, right? Now, coming to sheet swap. The whole idea of sheet swapping is to have multiple sheets in a dashboard. And the person can choose whatever sheet they want to see, whatever chart they want to see at one point of time. This way, we do not have to divide our dashboard into multiple views. So for creating this, let's just first create our sheet. So the first one is subcategory wise sales and profit analysis. So I'll again bring in my subcategory and I'll bring in my sales. And we have it. And the next one is a monthly sales analysis. Right. So I'll bring in my date. I'll convert it to one. And to also show the years, we'll have this. And I'll bring in my sales figure. And convert it to a line chart, right? Now the important thing here to do is again create a parameter which says maybe a sheet swap. Where I'll simply give my sheet names. Make sure that you know the sheet name which you have is the sheet name you give in your value. It should be exactly same. So I would suggest always copy paste and put it in here. And then whichever sheet you are on, now we'll create a calculated field which says sheet swap. We'll give this thing. Right now I am in this sheet 13, so I'll put it on filters and I'll choose sheet 13. Show parameter to sheet 14 and I'll go here, put sheet swap copy and I'll choose sheet 14. So whichever sheet you are on, always choose only that sheet, take that sheet and put it on filter shell and that's it. Now we'll go to a dashboard. Automatic. We'll put in a container and second container where I'll put both my sheets. And sheet 14. Right. The important thing to note here is that both your sheets should inside be one single container. If you put two different containers, then the sheet swap won't work. All right. So coming to the last parameter we have is using parameters in table calculation. Over here, what we're going to do is we'll find the running average of our profit or sales for each month in all the years. These is the kind of stuff which you know mostly stock people in stock market do, and we'll find a running average for maybe the last two data points or last six data points or last 12 data points, which means basically days. The first thing again we are gonna do is put our date, convert it to month, and again have our years, and just put profit, and again convert into a line chart. Now we'll add a quick table calculation which says I want to find the moving average of the last two days, right? But this last two is very static. I cannot change it. What if I want to see for the last 6 days or last 20 days or anything? So for that, we have to create again a parameter. Where I'll write last n days, and I'll convert it into an integer because I want to show last two, last 10. So because we are going backwards, we'll write everything in minus. So maybe I want to say for last 3 days, last 6 days, maybe last 12 days, and I want to display that last 3 days, last 6 days, and last 12 days, and done. Now we'll create a calculation. We'll go over here and we'll copy our table calculation, create a calculated field where instead of the static two, I'll simply put in my parameter, right? I'll give the name moving average. And I'll replace this with my sum with the moving average and show parameter. Now, whenever I select whatever days I want, I can see the moving average as per that. So this was all for the parameters. Now moving on to sets. So we are going to learn three things in sets, which is dynamic sets, customized filters using sets, and set actions. So what does dynamic sets mean? Whenever we create a set, it can be either dynamic or it can be static set. Dynamic set is something which changes as per the filters or as per the new dimensions you introduce in your view. So what is happening here, right? I have created a visualization which is saying, pointing out my top 10 customers. Top 10 customers in terms of sales. I want to highlight my top 10 customers for each year. I select 18, I want to see top 10 customers for 2018, and similarly for other years, right? So I'll quickly put my profit and sales and my customer name in detail. So I got the scatter plot. And now I want to create a set of my customers, right? I want to find my top 10 customers. So I'll go to top by field. And as per the sales, I want the top 10 customers. Right? And the set which we created, we'll put this in color because we want the top 10 to be colored and the rest to be grayed out. Now, whenever I bring anything into the view, for example, I'll bring in my date to the filter shell. And I'll do show filter. So let's see what happens. First, 2018. These are definitely not one of my top 10 customers, isn't it? They are somewhere very below. Now, why is this happening? This is happening because of the order of operation which Tableau follows. So right now, sets are coming above my filters. So what it's doing is the 10 sets which we have created is static, right? These people do not change. So if 2018, one of them was obviously not one of the top 10 customers. So even after filtering, the set remains static. So this customer goes down, right? So So this is where we need to make it dynamic. Very simple way is to just put my filters into context. Now this comes above my set. Now what happens is first the filtering happens and then a set is created. So now we're getting the right results. We're getting the top 10 customers for each year. Correct. All right. Now coming to customize filters using sets. This is something which I mostly use when, you know, I do not want to show all the data values to the person viewing my dashboard. For example, I have a list of 100 countries and only, you know, maybe a part of those countries are actually doing very well. And I only want to show those countries to my stakeholders or anyone who is viewing my dashboard. And whenever I put a filter of the countries, no matter what, like they just see, if I put all my cities over here and I want to only show maybe these 5 cities which are doing really well, right? Now the view got filtered, but when I do show filter, it shows me all the filters which I do not want. Now this is the case where I will simply create a set and use that set for all my analysis. So I'll go to my setting. I'll say create set on the basis of condition. I'm saying that just to create a set of all those cities where my sale is greater than or equal to maybe 50,000. And I'll call them develop states, or in this case, right? And now instead of I'll bring in my cities and I'll bring in this filter, develop cities. So these are my, I'll put my sales values. So these my are my only cities which have a sales value of more than 50,000. And when I show a filter, okay, so now this filter is only showing me a set of states which are developed, not all of them, right? If I do a show filter, it is only showing me these 3 states which are doing well. And coming to our cities, if I bring in the cities and sales value now, and develop cities, do a show filter, I'm only seeing the list of those cities which are doing which are developed and not all of them. Okay, now coming lastly to the set actions, over here what I want to do is I only want to highlight, for example, in a scatter plot when we have a lot of you know, details, like in this one I cannot really segregate one circle from another. So in this case, what I wanted to do was I wanted to highlight whichever circle I am going on. This can easily be done with the help of set actions. So again, I'll create the scatter plot first. Profit, sales, as per maybe are again known as per the city. Stick to that. I'll increase the size of it, make it a circle, reduce the opacity and give it a border color. But it is still not very visible, right? I cannot understand if I'm, where am I right now? So what I'll do is I'll go to my city, I'll create a set and I'll add any random city. What it does is it says that, you know, any one city at a point of time will be inside my set. And this is the city which I'll be hovering on. And whenever something is inside my set, I want it to be colored. So I'll give it the name, maybe selected city. And I'll put the selected city on my color shell. So what it does is right now, this particular city is inside my set, so it's colored. And the other are grayed out. Right, so it's much more easily understandable. But when I hover over others, it's not working right. So this is where I'll add a simple worksheet action where I'll say that, you know, change my set values. Change my set values to chosen city and assign whatever I am hovering on, assign that value to the set. But whenever I clear the selection, I just want to keep the set value. And okay. Okay, hover. Selected city is my set. I chose the wrong set. I'm sorry about it. And keep the set value. So now whenever I hover over a circle, that particular state city gets assigned to my set. And whenever something is inside my set, the color automatically changes to blue. All right, so this was it from my side.
Thank you so much, Vani. That was so fun to see all the actions and parameters and in action. Do you have a particular favorite that you have used or found yourself using a lot in real life?
Yes, I actually used this set, the coloring one, where I showed the top one, the dynamic sets which I showed. I highlighted the top 10, right? I use this a lot to show this in my bar graph to show maybe, you know, when I'm showing the value for 12 months or 6 months, I usually highlight the topmost value with the help of this.
That's great to hear. And thank you so much for your presentation. And thanks to Jody as well. Both presentations were so good. And we learned a lot today. So thanks everyone for attending this session. Have a great morning, afternoon, or evening, and enjoy your weekend. Just a quick note, I'm hosting a REMO event tomorrow with a lot of people attending. So feel free to reach out to me if you haven't received your invite to the REMO DataFam Hangout, which will be about 26 and a half hours from now. And you could hang out with everybody in our community. There's 100 or so people been invited. It's a nice networking event where you could sit at tables and move around as you like and meet many of your friends in the data fam. So thank you so much and enjoy your day.
Bye.